Hello and welcome to the first IPSPA webinar course of Systems and Synthetic Biology. This is the section which has been prepared by Dr. Xavier Garcia, which is myself, and my collaborator, Joan Albiol, from the Bioprocess Engineering and Applied Biocatalysis Group of the Universitat Autònoma de Barcelona. Specifically, we are in the Department of Chemical, Biological, and Environmental Engineering. This section of the seminar will be focused on a biotech application of systems and synthetic biology. For this case, we choose to present the bioproduction of cis muconic acid as a successful story for synthetic biology. This is an example that has been also chosen by Ibisba as an example of the synthetic biology cycle, since it is a bio-based potential chemical platform for the biosynthesis of value-added polymers. So, to start, we will firstly present an outline of the presentation, which will start with an introduction to the concept of biorefinery. Then we will go to the cis muconic industrial application and its market. Then we will go for the potential cell factories comparison, followed by the synthetic pathway construction for Saccharomyces cerevisiae. For this cell factory, we will identify the bottlenecks of the synthetic pathway. At the end, we will also evaluate recent alternatives that has emerged to this to the use of Saccharomyces cerevisiae as a cell factory, which is the Pseudomonas putidum. And we will finish this section with the conclusions of the presentation. Now you can see in the screen the main references that we have used for preparing this presentation. The two first are focused on the production using Saccharomyces cerevisiae, and the two last references are more focused on the use of Pseudomonas putida as a cell factory. So, to start, as I mentioned before, we will start with the presentation of the concept of biorefinery. Currently, biotechnology is promoting the transition from the petrol-based economy to the bioeconomy. And the aim of this transition is to promote renewable methods to produce commodity and specialty chemicals as an alternative to reduce the petroleum footprints. So in this context emerged the concept of integrated biorefineries, which aims the production of chemicals, biofuels, food, biomaterials, and energy from renewable biological feedstock, which means biomass. So the main idea of these biorefineries is being an alternative to the petroleum refineries, which are able to produce a wide range of add value products. But the main advantages of biorefineries in front of the petrochemical classic refineries is that we are working in a close carbon balance. So we are not introducing more carbon in the atmosphere. And another very important advantage is that with an energy input from the sun, we are able to produce chemicals in a sustainable way. So in this context, the bioplastic is a production is a direct application. So basically that means that synthetic biology allows us to produce bioplastic precursors to develop novel bioplastic alternatives from renewable biological feedstocks, which means biomass. As an example, we have selected the adipic acid, which is positioned in the top 50 of the bulk chemicals produced currently. it is normally used for the production of chemical precursors for a wide range of applications. So as a, for example, nylon, lubricants, coatings, plastics, and plasticizers. And as you can see in the screen, the market of the adipic acid in the picture is depicted the current and future market in the US is growing importantly, and is expected to be growing importantly until at least 2024. So, if we produce this adipic acid by chemical synthesis, we will require a big important amount of energy, which has a strong environmental impact. So, as alternative, the bio-based refineries propose the production of adipic acid from muconic acid. Specifically, the C6 muconic acid is easily convertible into adipic acid, avoiding all the drawbacks derived from the chemical processes, especially the environmental impact. So, this C6 muconic acid can be obtained from biosynthetic production platforms. Specifically, this C6 muconic acid cannot be produced endogenously from carbohydrates from the standard surfactories normally used. However, it is produced during the catabolism and the detoxification of aromatic compounds by yeast and bacteria. And these are the features that we are going to use for producing our synthetic surfactory, constructing our synthetic surfactory. So basically, these recombinant surfactories will be able to produce C6 muconic acid from renewable feedstocks via heterologous synthetic pathway. From this point, we will start with the surfactories comparison. The widely known bacteria Escherichia coli was the first engineered surfactory able to produce C6 muconic acid derived from a synthetic pathway. Basically, we need to introduce three recombinant enzymes in the surfactory to let the metabolism as a rational modifications that led the metabolins to produce C6 muconic acid. However, the industrial bioprocesses are moving towards the use of yeast platforms. In the figure now, you can see the example of the bioethanol production using yeast. And we will present the advantages of using yeast in the following slide. And for the specific case of the C6 muconic acid production, Saccharomyces cerevisiae is used for the production of bioplastic precursors via the shikimate and amino acids pathways that is very briefly presented in this small figure, but we will see more detailed in the following slides. So, comparing the advantages of Saccharomyces in front of E. coli for the industrial application of bioprocesses, Saccharomyces is able to work at lower temperatures, has better growth at low pHs, it has also higher tolerances to high concentration products. We avoid the risk of fake contamination. Normally, these bioprocessors are easier to separate, and they have better scalability. And now, in the following picture, you can see the example of the typical cycle that is used to develop a synthetic metabolic pathway. It can be used for Saccharomyces, but it can be used also for other cell factories. So basically, the strength, the different steps are firstly the strain construction, then the screening, then the test in bioreactor, and then to analyze the data in order to start again the cycle and achieve increase in the production rates. So now we will enter into details in the synthetic pathway constructions for Saccharomyces cerevisiae, which basically use the same route that was used for Escherichia coli. So basically, we will need the recombinant expression of three enzymes that will convert the compounds that are produced in the c-Kymet pathway into cis-cis muconic acid. So as you see in the figure present in the slide, we will need to add three enzymes which are indicated at 6, 7, and 8. The 6 is specifically the dehydroxy-c-Kymet dehydratase. Then the 7, the PCA decarboxylase, which is the protocatalate decarboxylase. And then the last enzyme, the number 8, is the catechol 1,2 deoxygenase. So when we have to express recombinantly these enzymes, we can choose different native expressors, and in the slide you can see some of the examples that were selected by the users to take the DNA expressor from. So as example, we would go into details for the synthetic step 8, which is the catalyzed by the enzyme catechol 1,2 deoxygenase. So in the work published by Karan et al. At 2013, they basically compare 4 different alternatives for these enzymes for the catechol 1,2 deoxygenase. You can see it in the table presented in the slide. 2 were from Acetinobacter, another from Candida albicans, and another from Debra isomyces hansei. So when having to produce, to construct the strains producing these different alternatives for the recombinant enzyme, they always followed the same structure of work. Firstly, it's needed to make the enzyme selection. It's essential to choose the native producer, and then it's also very important to being able to identify the coding DNA sequence. Once we have this coding DNA sequence, we need to clone this expression cassette into the vector, and it's highly recommended to perform the codon optimization, because now the price of the synthetic genes has decreased very importantly. So we have the possibility to optimize the codon use, which normally increases the performance of the recombinant enzymes. So then, once we have our chimeric plasmid constructed, we have to transformate it, and we have to select the positive transformants. And once we have the positive transformants, we need to test the clones, and we have different alternatives. So this is the same table that I present in the previous slide, when we have the 4 different alternatives for the synthetic step 8, the catechol 1,2 deoxygenase. And after integrating this synthetic pathway with the three steps 6, 7, and 8, for the first time, the authors were able to produce cis-muconic acid with saccharomyces, but initially they have very low titers. So they were looking for other alternatives that it could allow them to increase the yield of productions. So as the first option, the author tried to relieve the amino acid feedback repression. It is due to the aromatic, because the aromatic amino acid biosynthesis is a tightly regulated process. So basically, the intermediate flux in the shikimate and aromatic pathway is subjected to significant allosteric regulation. And that means that the feedback inhibition of this pathway may limit the flux into the cis-muconic synthetic pathway. So in this pathway, there is a key role of the DHAP synthase in the regulation. The DHAP means dehydroxyacetone phosphate, and is a key enzyme involved in this regulation. So the authors, basically what they did is knocking out the endogenous DAHP synthase, and they express recombinantly the homologous enzyme from Escherichia coli. And this modification resulted into very significant increase of cis-muconic acid production. So also explaining more details about this feedback repression and the key role of the DHAP synthase. Basically, with the pathway engineering, what the authors achieved was to block the aromatic amino acid biosynthesis pathway, and they also performed an overexpression of the arom gene from E. coli, and it has a pronounced effect on the PCA levels. The PCA is the protocatalate discarboxylase. And comparing the results, the authors were able to achieve a dramatic production increase of the protocatalate. But this was not the only tools that the authors used to increase the yield of the synthetic pathway. They also identify other bottlenecks, and the idea of the bottlenecks appear when they were measuring the intermediate pathways in the cultures. So during the cultures, they detected relevant amount of protocatalate, and they did not could determine any significant amount of catechol. But this this apparition of protocatalate, it was a signal that the PCA discarboxylase enzyme could be a bottleneck of the pathway. So in order to avoid it, they did an action that was the overexpression of the recombinant enzyme, and they could observe an increase of transcription. However, they did not see any relevant effect on the pathway, which means that there could be a possible limitation at transcriptional level. So another ideas that come out from measuring pathway intermediates was the possible compound diffusion across the plasma membrane, which is unlikely, but a more likely idea is the specific transport of molecules. So the intermediate might be draining out of the cells, which would reduce the final seismogonization production levels. So the systems biology can provide a solution for this training. That could be the identification of the transporters of intermediate molecules and knocking out the coding chains of these transporters of the intermediates. And also another possible solution would be the identification of enzymes with higher activities and higher affinities. That would increase the efficiency of the synthetic pathway. The authors also wanted to identify more possible solutions by means of metabolic engineering, and for that they used the genome scale model EMM904 in order to perform flux balance analysis. So the idea after using this flux balance analysis was that to maximize the seismogonic acid production, it was necessary to promote the flux of the fructose cis phosphate and glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate, and also to promote the transcatalyzed reaction in the pentose phosphate pathway to produce erythrose 4 phosphate and xylose 5 phosphate, which are pointed on in the reaction. So the systems biology provide a solution for that, which was the overexpression of the transcatalase chains and the knockout of the glucose cis phosphate dehydrogenase. And this allows to rewiring of the pentose phosphate pathway, leading into important increase of up to twofold in terms of yield. So also other additional targets can be identified for or even overexpression of knockout. So taking into account all these possibilities, the final result obtained with the seismogonic acid production were obtained in batch cultures with an initial concentration of 40 grams per liter of glucose in a cultivation time of 60 hours, and the final product titer was more than 140 milligrams per liter, and the substrate yield was about 4 milligrams of seismogonic acid per gram of glucose. These results can be also further increased by optimizing the culture conditions. Here in the table, we present a comparison with other amino acid-based production yeast, in which this production of seismogonic acid is the best one. Now, comparing the performance of yeast and E. coli for these bioprocesses, for yeast, we should consider that the aromatic amino acid-based production is still poor, and this is an outstanding metabolic engineering challenge. On the other hand, for E. coli, the production of grams per liter has been achieved, which is very important. And this means that alleviating the feedback inhibition reach is straightforward by genetic modification. These differences are based on the metabolic path network of Saccharomyces cerevisiae, which is more rigidly resistant to modifications. So there are further steps in terms of metabolic engineering that could be implemented to yeast that could increase the results in yeast. So for sure, these low results are as a result of the highly regulated aromatic amino acid pathway, which is regulated probably at both global and local transcription machinery. Some proteins also could be identified as responsible for controlling the overall flux through the shikimate pathway. So, as presented before, the systems biology can provide solutions for that and allow a better strain engineering. So in order to do that, systems biology would allow to obtain suitable chassis for shikimate-based molecules production, which would be a sustainable bioplastic and polymer precursors. As alternative to that, to the use of E. coli and Saccharomyces cerevisiae as a surfactory, lately has emerged the alternative of using Pseudomonas putida, which is a metabolic versatile bacteria that can use aromatic compounds as a carbon source for growth and energy production. And the use of this bacteria, Pseudomonas putida, would be an alternative to convert lignocellulosic biomass into value-added products. So, for the design of the synthetic pathway for Pseudomonas putida, systems biology provide a solution which is based on the knockout of two genes, which are the protoquate deoxygenase and the CATB, which is a cycloisomerase, and is also required the expression of the PDC, which is a protoquate decarboxylase. And by implementing these engineering actions, the production of cis mucronic acid will require also glucose, the combination of glucose and lignocellulosic. And in order to be able to produce cis mucronic acid from only lignin or from only glucose, we will require to introduce more genetic modifications. By implementing these mentioned modifications, we could obtain up to 15 grams per liter of lignin monomers and up to 5 grams per liter of glucose. So, comparing the results between Saccharomyces and E. coli, the results are better than from that comparing to Saccharomyces and lower than to comparing with E. coli. So, as advantages, Pseudomonas present the advantage of the ability to produce value product from lignin residues, but that it presents a bad performance in scalable bioprocesses. This is basically, as a conclusion, the comparison of the three possible alternatives to produce the cis mucronic acid: E. coli, which present high titer and yield, but presents also a poor performance in a scalable process; the Saccharomyces cerevisiae, which present low titer and yield, but has a good performance in scalable bioprocesses; and Pseudomonas putida, which present a medium titer and yield and can use lignin as a primary material, but has a poor performance in scalable processes. All alternatives present advantages and drawbacks that should be balanced in order to select a host for implementation of a scalable bioprocesses. And that was all for this example of a synthetic pathway.